Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Woodstock, Interviews and Recollections, by Dale Bell. Read by Peter Berkrot and Exe Sands. Foreword, Martin Scorcese, on Woodstock. Woodstock obviously emerged from its historical moment. And one of the things about that moment was that everyone was waiting for a big defining event that would counteract all the awful things that had happened. There was the music. There was the idea of rejecting the rest of the world and living in a natural state. There was the drug culture. There was the political stance against the government, specifically its policy in Vietnam. And they all came together in this moment. It's interesting that people called it the Woodstock Nation, because that's what people wanted, to be separate, to have their own community. And for 3 days they had it. When I look back at the second half of the 60s, I realize it is the only time I have ever heard people talk about love in serious terms, as a force to combat greed, hate, and violence. What does it symbolize today? What will it symbolize for future generations? Well, what does the Paris Commune symbolize today? What do the New York draft riots symbolize today? They're events from a more distant past, but it's the same past that Woodstock is now receding into. What it symbolizes is that things can happen, incredible events that are the product of many particular elements converging at a particular moment. And those events can't be repeated. Look at Woodstock, too. But the fact that something new did happen on a grand scale, something that felt like nothing else that had ever happened before, means that something entirely new can happen again, in a way that we can't predict. Martin Scorsese. Introduction. Dale Bell, associate producer of the film Woodstock. It seems like yesterday. A group of long-haired freaks, clad in bell-bottom jeans and tattered hairbands, some sporting cowboy hats, invade the Warner Brothers lot in Burbank, California in the early winter of 1970. Tumbleweeds dance in the Santa Ana winds among the vacant sound stages. Tall grass forces its way through the empty tarmac. It looks like the day the earth stood still. Or is it Stanley Kramer's On the Beach? We say to each other, is this the Hollywood we've all dreamed of? Only a handful of security people greet us, wondering who we are. Where did we come from? What are we doing on their premises? And what, they demand, is that weird gear we're trucking onto their lot? What are editing tables? We know film, they say. A Western twang to our New York ears. Film editing machines always go up and down, not sideways. Ribbing each other at our expanse, they tease, your long hair is going to get caught in the reels of film. Maybe you'd better wear hairnets. From their offices above and around us, Fred Weintraub, producer, John Calley, worldwide production chief, and Ted Ashley, chairman, must have been looking on bemused. Back in New York City, the chairman of Atlantic Records, Ahmet Ertegun, might have been smiling like the Cheshire Cat. The boss of all of them, silver-haired and tongued Steve Ross, might have been clapping his hands in glee. Not one of them knew then that our hippie movie, Woodstock, would pay their salaries, keep their children in school, allow them to take their vacations, and enrich their stockholders. Much less that it would finance the rebirth of the once mighty Warner Brothers, revolutionizing the music business at the same time. Nor did anyone know how our movie would affect the drug culture, the war in Vietnam, the civil rights struggles in the South, or the aftermath of Kent State. How many times since have writers, musicians, commentators, comedians, and politicians invoked the event they experienced only on film, in vain or in glory? A scant 4 months earlier, August 15th, 16th, and 17th, 1969, the jubilant days that now live for generations, Half a million people had forged a pilgrimage to a tiny spot in New York State. We had trekked along with the largest, most highly sophisticated documentary film unit ever assembled to record it all. No precedent to guide our efforts. The presence of drugs was a certainty. The crowd could become uncontrollable. Pandemonium? Nirvana? Madness? Peace and love? Mayhem? As each performing group of musicians found their way to the front of the vast platform to face their daunting audience of loyal, peaceful fans, we filmmakers huddled on the lip of the stage, making plans. Film loads were calculated, camera positions assigned, songs from the set selected, style was discussed. But we were fearful that our 15 cameramen would run out of precious film if the helicopters couldn't land with our mandatory cargo. We were entirely without financial means, just enough to purchase raw stock. Everything else was a house of cards built on promise and speculation and many gut feelings. As late as 2 weeks before the festival, in early August, no one was preparing to make the movie. Somehow we had assembled this massive crew and a complete kit of the best equipment available in the space of 6 days, without funding. And now here we were, in it. Bonded together by camaraderie and adrenaline, we fought off claustrophobia, fear, heat, hunger, and sleep. Working from plywood sawhorse tables underneath the massive stage, deprived of food and water, covered with mud and rain, risking electrocution in the windy thunderstorms of Saturday, virtually sleepless for 3 nights, we moved synchronously through our paces like an army. Runners assigned to each of the 6 onstage cameramen gathered like ball boys in tournament tennis, ready to leap forward when a cameraman needed help or a new roll of film. Loaders beneath the stage, their sweating arms immersed in black film changing bags, loaded and unloaded magazines tirelessly in ankle-deep mud, knowing that one scratch on the emulsion of one film roll could ruin a good day's or night's work. During daylight hours, when we could maneuver among the throng of 500,000 people, we tried to determine the kinds of stories we would be able to cover before nightfall, for everyone knew that the documentary sequences would be equally as important as the music. We were mindful to keep our eyes out for spontaneous situations and to film what interested us, to turn off when we lost interest. Never before, and need I say never since, despite so many attempts at imitation, had such advanced technology been married so dynamically, so swiftly, so harmoniously, to a vision we filmmakers had developed independently in the tumultuous cauldron of the 60s. Over the course of a short but turbulent journey, we were thrown together, total strangers and lifelong friends, to pool our collective experiences, our skills, our wisdom, and our vision, to create for future generations a single revolutionary memoir. As none of us could truly assess its impact before the movie was released, we were unaware that we were creating a symbol for an age. But driven by the desire to get it right, we managed to record, live on film for posterity, the most successful documentary the world has ever known. An icon of this century. Woodstock. I always considered myself the least likely person to be at White Lake, New York, that August of 1969. Because my head had always been saturated with Broadway melodies, interlaced with Bach, Beethoven, and Brahms, and sometimes Chopin. There was no place for Baez, Butterfield, or what was that name? Sly and the Family Stone. I was busy raising my family. 3 small sons, Jonathan, David, and Andrew, with my wife Anne in a Victorian 3-story gingerbread house on the banks of the Hudson River, facing the vast Tappan Zee. Had we inherited the mantle of revolution from former owner Betty Friedan, whose The Feminine Mystique called for a changed role for women and had been written in our bedroom only 6 years earlier? We had just returned from spending a year in Washington, where I was part of the press corps in public television. This assignment brought me in touch with President Johnson, cabinet members, and the likes of Ralph Nader. I counted myself a member of the establishment, I was by no means a long hair, and I had a few friends who were. Most of them were more than a little intimidating to me. In 1965, I had hired Michael Wadley and John Binder, fresh out of NYU Film School, and had given them their first official jobs. They had long hair and iconoclastic minds. But because they were so good and so different in personality from other crews who were walking the halls of educational television in New York in 1965, they quickly received calls from other producers. Soon, Mike and John were working regularly, traveling the world, meeting other camera crews like themselves, picking up on new technologies. Natural light, cinema verite, affected by handheld cameras being designed in France and Germany. These new cameras could revolutionize traditional 35mm news gathering. So aware were Mike and John of the importance of harnessing these innovations in cameras, recorders, and post-production gear that they visited engineers and factories in France, Switzerland, and Germany, and explored applications of the equipment to new concepts in filmmaking. They weren't alone. Others of us, pioneering in educational television, found ourselves more advanced than commercial networks in our urgency to marry live satellite broadcasts with energetically talking heads, each ready to dissect the latest State of the Union address, for example. Yet our burgeoning medium was still searching for a message. In 1966, adhering to the Aristotelian unities of time, place, and action, I devised a program that would be filmed within a 24-hour day by 13 cameramen located in 10 different spots between San Diego and London, as though it was live on film. On this project, I brought together Mike, by then Wads to my ding, and David Myers, the legendary cameraman from the Bay Area who would become our collective mentor. Yet Mike and John Binder remained close friends who brought their families and friends to our house on the river. Gradually, in the winter and spring of 1969, I found myself anticipating unemployment for the first time since I had been married. Mike and John invited me to work out of their offices on Upper Broadway until I could find something permanent. It was there that I came in contact with a whole new breed of long-haired, ingenious, funny, inventive, passionate, brilliant, and sometimes weird people who were to change my life completely. Among them was the very youthful Larry Johnson, almost an alter ego of Michael, whose spiritual sense of the powerful music of his generation might have surpassed even his technical ability to record it and deliver it purely to another medium. Our encounters were tentative at first, but suspicion quickly gave way to mutual respect and appreciation. There was no way to ignore those infectious minds, the sense of camaraderie, the philosophical dichotomy, the sluice of energy that coursed up and down Manhattan. After all, we were filmmakers, above and underground, destined to take on the world. By virtue of the extraordinary variety of our work, we were fast becoming the eyes and ears of the thinking, caring populace in the United States and abroad. Our portable cameras had catapulted us to the front lines. Our responsibility was to tell it like it was. And so we were uniquely poised to leap into action when the festival happened. From the moment the film opened in March 1970, a scant 8 months after the incredible experience on Maxie Asger's farm, I knew that someday, somehow, our story had to be told. Soon after I returned home on the Hudson River, I was deluged with requests to talk about my experiences. So as not to forget too much, I took some elaborate notes, gave several talks to students, and recorded the lectures so that at least my family and I would have them for posterity. Even today, when people discover that I helped to make this movie, I'm asked, "What was it like?" My experience was just one of many. I cannot pretend to know how it affected those who were friends first, employees second, and extended family forever. Far be it from me to try to verbalize or homogenize their experiences. Nor should I. Far better for me to ask them to talk for themselves. It was on this supposition that I asked them all to help in the production of this reunion on paper. Each of the 80-some people we brought to the site has a story to tell. How they got there, what they expected, what they encountered, how it affected them. Couple those on site with dozens more people in editing rooms that stretch from New York to Hollywood, and the extended family expands logarithmically. We would work together, eat together, marry and live together, and finally, we would grow into maturity, which is exactly where you find all of us right now, talking about our children and grandchildren. We've had reunions, gathering together with our families on the anniversary days in mid-August. How many other film crews in the history of the cinema have kept in touch for 30 years? But this reunion is different. It permits us to tell our stories as filmmakers, not the story of the festival itself, which has already been analyzed and spun to a fare thee well. What I have assembled through this effort are recollections which may have remained private to them for all these years. Some were there at the very beginning, before there was even a mention of a Woodstock festival, before the KEM, or the Keller as it was first called, was invented, before Merv Griffin assumed an unwitting role as godfather of the multiple screen concept, which later led to our ability to create a kaleidoscopic movie. Some joined the production after the event, still others were added during the final days of post-production. Most of us were unaware of the attempts by other filmmakers to secure the rights to film the festival. My recent conversations with Ahmet Erdogan, chairman and founder of Atlantic Records, and with Porter Bibb, then working as a producer on behalf of Al and David Mazels, have yielded very curious results, told here for the first time. All of us seem to be like ships passing in the night, unaware of the other's activities until now. Unraveling our little history still holds a great deal of fascination. I wrote the following letter to our extended family in June 1998. I need your help. I see this as a chance to preserve our story, how each of us contributed individually to the collective whole. Since the initial release of the movie and the accompanying magazine articles, this is the first opportunity I know of where those of us who made the film can actually tell our own stories and right some wrongs in the process. To me, that is an important distinction, one which should make this book interesting to a film audience as well as to listeners more interested in our imprint on the world's culture. I have always been impressed with the impact Woodstock has had on the fabric of America, but it has not, in my opinion, been limited to a sociological blot. Rather, I believe we affected how a generation was perceived, how music was written, recorded, marketed, and how it gave birth to the music industry we know today. How electronic and digital innovations developed from our extraordinary marriage of vision and new technology. How the production of sound for movies, including Dolby, THX, and surround, evolved through techniques we invented. How non-linear editing grew from our use of multiple image KEMs. How performers were billed, marketed, and sent around the world on tours which had no precedent prior to our movie. How movie marketing to young people was transformed once we had drawn a new audience into the movie theaters. How our movie gave birth to MTV, Saturday Night Live, or how the establishment embraced and co-opted our revolutionary images, in spite of our efforts to deny them access. And basically, how we long hairs managed to astound the world with an historic icon, born in synchronicity. Nothing could have been accomplished had it not been for this totally unique synthesis. You may have had your own views of these manifestations. I want to try to get them out of you. Witnessing the remixing of the director's cut just 5 years ago reassured me that, together, we have created a monument to film history which remains as fresh and dynamic today as when it was first released almost 30 years ago. These are our stories, mingled with perceptions from some of the performers and others whose work contributed to the success of the movie. In keeping with the tenor of our original times, I think of this project as a cinema verite book. To mirror the movie itself, this is also a multiple image book. As a bookmaker, then, I have tried to minimize my intrusion into the content of others, as though I were a filmmaker, allowing objectivity and individual storytelling to emerge. As a result of this Rashomon experiment, you may be hearing sections of our history through different ears, thus some repetition may be evident. I hope you can tolerate an occasional overlap. Think of it as a double exposure or a long dissolve. You may also perceive some instant replay, slow-mo, and stop-motion animation. Allow your memory to collect this accumulated experience, a piece, and a personality at a time. The truth about this movie, which almost didn't get made, emerges. By pulling all of our collective experiences together, I hope that those of us who may have caused pain to others in the odyssey of making this film will be shown compassion and forgiveness. It's not an excuse to be lured by a mysterious siren, but we were alive in extraordinarily tumultuous times, with a responsibility as documentarians to record them. We might have thought we were exempt from normal society, the untouchables. Maybe we had to believe we were in order to succeed at our craft, but it was an illusion that would haunt some of us the rest of our lives. Dale Bell, Grandview on Hudson, New York, and Mission Hills, California. Merv Griffin, The Freeing of America. We refer to Merv Griffin as the godfather of Woodstock, for his innovative assignments to the Wadley film team provided them an experimental laboratory for new cinematic technique. Merv, what can I tell you about Woodstock? Dale, tell me what you remember. Merv, is Michael Wadley still alive? Dale, very much so, and in New Hampshire, and sends his best. Merv, oh my God, give him my love. Dale, I will. Merv, he was such a different kind of guy, for a photographer at that time. A film photographer. He was very kind of aesthetic, almost fragile, but you realize there was a genius there behind that camera. Dale, you're absolutely right. Merv, I think the first thing Michael did, when we flew together in that DC-3 airplane I chartered out of New Jersey, that was to do... I did Sidewalks of New York, Sidewalks of New England, a Thanksgiving Day show with the kids at my farm. Is that all I did on the sidewalk things? Dale, in Providence, you did Aretha Franklin's concert. Merv, yes, and then we did that baggage sequence with Paul Revere and the Raiders at the Boston airport. And I did a couple of songs. We were using the turning of the leaves in New England as background because it was so spectacular and so colorful. Dale, what do you remember about this merry gang of filmmakers? Merv, there was some innovation they had in shooting. It was very cinema verite. I mean, Michael was afraid of nothing camera-wise. He wasn't locked into the moves of the day. In other words, he was very adventuresome behind that camera. I remember we did Quiet Nights on a rocky beach where I was walking the rocks, you know, in a kind of cold weather outfit doing Quiet Nights and the Quiet Stars, which had been pre-recorded by the orchestra, and I was singing it live. He was the most awesome photographer. Dale, well, he was. Unfortunately, he stopped doing it, the damned fool. Merv, has he stopped? Dale, yeah. He's writing and he's producing CD-ROMs and he's written screenplays, but he has not been a cinematographer virtually since Woodstock. No, in 1975 we did something together. Merv, I just recall the time I think he mortgaged his house, his family, his wife's ballet shoes, everything, to do Woodstock. Dale, what did you think about the movie? Merv, it was fabulous. There has never been a gathering like that. Oh, there have been gatherings, but not with that spirit. I mean, it was the first. To have a memory like that recorded of the first of anything is wonderful. Dale, what impact did it have? Merv, it was tremendous. And of course, that was the decade everything, every institution broke down. It was the freeing of America, good or bad. It just took away the reins that were on everybody and the framework that was around everything you did. My show is a great platform for all the people who protested everything. The show was on nighttime in New York and other major cities, Metro Media. Jane Fonda couldn't get on any television show except mine. And the reason she could get on mine was because we were syndicated, so there was nobody who could say, Merv, you can't have her on. that she was persona non grata on the networks, as was Muhammad Ali. He was not allowed on. All the civil protests came on my show, the mailers, and on the other hand, we gave equal time to the Buckleys and everybody else. But my platform was the source of speaking out in America, and they couldn't stop me. I had on the first protest against, by a world-famous person, against the Vietnam War, Lord Bertrand Russell, who later ran the Vietnam War Crimes Trial in Sweden. Bob Considine, who was the front-page writer of the then Journal American of New York, wrote that Merv Griffin should be taken off the air for what he's done. And his son was my cameraman, Barry, on the show. And he wrote this piece, and I answered him. He said, "We're in wartime, and Merv Griffin puts on a protest against America." And I said, "We're not in wartime. What are you talking about? It's a police action. No war has been declared." Dale, how do you feel about that today, Merv Griffin?
Merv, I feel good about it. It was a contribution. I was the only one ever allowed to go to Alcatraz to tape the Indians, which I did, when they took over Alcatraz.
My philosophy of the show is that there were many voices speaking in America. Not all of them do you agree with, but you should hear them. They should have some place to speak. Of course, it was misused, too. The New York Daily News would run out and cover what they called a major protest, and there would be four wackos standing on a corner with some signs. But they would build it up like it was something. And then one night, a whole black organization took over my show. They rose up out of the audience. They contacted every pressman in New York and told them it was going to happen, but they didn't tell me. With these high African whistles. But they picked the wrong show. It was during the Vietnam War, and I stopped. I let the cameras go. And I said, "Okay, who's your spokesman, and now what are you protesting?" And they said there weren't enough black jazz musicians in my orchestra. And I said, "There are four. What are you talking about? It's a quarter of the orchestra," I said. "You picked the wrong place and the wrong cause. Do you know what's going on in the world?" So that kind of made their thing poop out. Michael, he was a part of that too. He photographed the happening of the youth and their music. Dale, every one of us was doing this in New York City in the 60s. Merv, my God, well, all of it was happening on my show. Remember the famous one that made the front pages? When the kid, Abby Hoffman, from the Chicago 7 came on my show, and he was wearing what CBS said, by that time I left syndication and had been on CBS 2 years, he was wearing the American flag. They said you cannot wear a flag as a piece of clothing. And so they prodded him out of the show with an electric prod and just left me talking to a black screen. And then, when I did the commercial, Roy Rogers and Dale Evans came up in the same shirts for Ford Motor Company. Bob Woods from CBS almost had a heart attack. Michael Wadley, Triumph of the Will. Interview with Michael Wadley, director of Woodstock, on the Warner Brothers lot in Burbank, California, spring 1994, while completing the remixing of the soundtrack and adding some 40 minutes to the original length of 3 hours, 4 minutes for the definitive version, the director's cut. Dale, did you have any idea back then that it was going to be anything more than a concert? That it would be this big thing we call Woodstock and have a different connotation? Michael, absolutely. I mean, you gotta remember that Woodstock started out as a village that was famous as a radical gathering place. That in 1919, in the village of Woodstock, the American Communist Party was started. In the 1920s, all sorts of radicals came up there. Socialists and everything else. In the 50s, Allen Ginsberg went there. In the 60s, Bob Dylan, Joan Baez, everybody else. So we really had a sense that we were a continuation of the traditions of that village in making the festival. So we thought we were onto something big. And then, of course, when we got that beautiful farm from Max Yasker with pastures and lake and bird stands and everything, we thought, well, this is a place where people are going to want to come. And sure enough, 500,000 people got there. And 3 million tried to get there. That's what the cops said on the roads. Dale, at the time, though, were you so busy working that you couldn't absorb this, or was it pretty clear right as it was happening? Michael,
I think it was pretty clear right as it was happening. Because 500,000 people you don't overlook. And then also, as a kind of barometer, when we saw the New York Times headline, well, for 2 days running, we got full-width banner headlines for the New York Times. So we thought, well, we're going to really be something. Everyone thinks of it as sort of the seminal event of the 60s generation, indeed. We're called the Woodstock generation after the festival. But the other interesting thing is that it's like the Canterbury Tales or the Pilgrim's Progress. It's really a timeliness idea, where you see kids streaming out of the cities that are so dirty and complex and pollution-ridden and crime-ridden, coming to the countryside. You know, back to the land, back to the garden, to sort of this pristine natural setting that has the lakes and trees and so on, and the innocence of nature. And then you see the sort of cathedral erected in nature, where the wooden stage goes up, where the choirs will come to sing, where the priests will give the sermons, where the jugglers and the clowns will perform. So I guess really the responsibility of the documentary may be that it might turn into something of a more timeless nature, where the general human condition, where war and peace and generation gap and human rights and so on, our relationship with the earth, can all be looked at within a kind of metaphorical context or construct called Woodstock. Dale, having been there yourself and experienced the whole thing, literally from start to finish, are there things that the movie doesn't capture? I mean, what does the movie capture, and what did you have to be there to kind of be a part of? Michael, well, even there, I think the reason for the film's length was that when Thelma, Schoonmaker, Marty, Scorsese, and others and I were editing the film, we never thought we were editing a film. We thought we were editing an experience, that we wanted to take you there, you know? So that part of the POV that you might miss if it were a brief film, and part of the experience, would be the length of it. So we thought that we really needed a long film to make it more like the surrogate experience. But for us, of course, who were there, the thing that isn't shown is the arduousness of making the movie. Just the sheer ability to stay awake for 4 days in a row. You know, I took speed. Most of my crew did, just to keep focused. We certainly didn't have any marijuana or beer or anything like that. We would have all gone to sleep and zonked out instantly. So in a way, we couldn't be quite as free to enjoy the event since we were working. Dale, when you look back at it now, are there images that only come into focus 25 years later? Michael, well, the thing that I also keep remembering, maybe because I'm embroiled in it now, are certain performances, like Jimi Hendrix doing the Star Spangled Banner. I can transport myself back there to see that man play as if it's happening like today. I'm not talking about the film, but he was such an incredible musician and had such a oneness about his guitar and his body. It was virtually like he took his own guts and strung them in place of the strings, really playing his own body. I've often thought of that, and, of course, thought of him as maybe an example of the kind of loss we all feel for the idealism of the 60s, which seems to have all vanished. Dale, overall, this whole picture, how do you describe it now to people who weren't there? Michael, well, as Jerry Garcia says in the movie, it was a biblical, epical, unbelievable scene. And it truly was biblical and epical. You had your masses, you had all your essential body functions from eating and drinking to taking a dump to what have you. You had your music, you had your entertainment, you had your jugglers, clowns, priests, and everything else going on there. So I think more and more people are describing Woodstock as an epic. You know, as the sort of left-wing version of Triumph of the Will. That it's just one of those larger-than-life experiences, and it really was. Dale, you kind of got thrust into being the guy who did Woodstock. Michael, but then I would point out to you that, as television journalists, as movie journalists, we have tremendous responsibility. We, collectively, are the most powerful media that this planet has, and we're so influential. Take drugs, for example. The film seems to be arguing for drugs. And here, 25 years later, we have this disastrous, horrendous problem with hard drugs. So in a way, you have to look at what you did then, look at the situation today and say, well, did I do the right thing? Dale, responsibility for the Woodstock generation? Michael, well, I was raised by two very good parents who instilled in me the fact that you were supposed to step up to the plate and put your ego aside. I'm trying, and I hope I'm doing it now, articulating concerns that a lot of people had. Part of the richness I think people ignore about Woodstock is the richness of alternatives. After all, in America, one of the big things we're supposed to be is the land of individuals, which means individual opinion, alternatives, you know? Well, I think what Woodstock symbolizes is counterculture, alternative culture, alternative points of view, alternative lifestyles, questioning everything. The biggest realization, it wasn't so much a look back as a look at a timeless situation. Country Joe's song wasn't really about the Vietnam War. It's about all wars. Joan Baez's song about Joe Hill is about all organizers. Freedom and Handsome Johnny songs that Richie Havens sings. Summertime blues that there ain't no cure for them because your congressman won't get you a job. And on and on. They're all metaphors. They work today every bit as well as they did yesterday. Dale, has it sunk in these years later any deeper, or is it pretty much the same? Michael, absolutely. I suppose it went through four basic phases. First was the excitement of becoming partners with the guys who were putting this thing on. Wow, we're going to do this event. Then the depressive feeling that it would never happen, that we couldn't get the political clearances, that it would just be a great idea that never was. Third, then, the exhilaration of it actually happening, and then beyond our wildest dreams with all these people coming. Then fourth, the horrible responsibility which turned into a nightmare of actually getting the film made. When the rain happened, there were power surges in the electricity. Then it knocked out the motors on eight cameras that I had. I mean, they were just fried. So I lived in terror that I actually wouldn't have the equipment to finish the piece. And, indeed, when Jimi Hendrix plays the last piece of music, we were down to three cameras. That was it. And then, of course, you move into the post-coital things of, we made it through that. Now let's sit down and see what we've got. Working with Thelma Schoonmaker, who I think is the greatest editor that's ever lived, working with her to put the film together on something that's got to be one of the most ambitious films ever made, even to this day, ambitious in terms of its editing. After all, we shot 160 hours. The finished film is 4 hours long, but with the multiple images, we use 10 hours of film. And 16 to 1, as you know, that's not much of a ratio. Then it came out and we won the Academy Award. We became the highest-grossing documentary of all time. That was great. And then the downside of it was, for me, my personality in a way. I got too much credit. You know, my partners who put on the event were sort of forgotten, and the guy who made the movie, which now became the event for millions of people around the world, had to become a spokesman for it. And after a while, especially after the 60s ended and the whole country turned to the right, people would literally call me in the middle of the night and ask, what does it all mean? Where are we going? And I'd say, fuck, hell if I know, give me a break. Dale, you kind of got thrust into being the guy who did Woodstock. Michael, but then I would point out to you that as television journalists, as movie journalists, we have tremendous responsibility. We, collectively, are the most powerful media that this planet has, and we're so influential. So therefore, our work, whether I'm giving an interview to you, whether you're making a documentary, or whether I am, I think it has tremendous impact on people. As role models, as surrogate experiencers, as experiences people would like to have. If you say that this is the most famous documentary of all time, then shit, the filmmaker has to say, well, did I do the right thing? Take drugs, for example. As you know, there is a famous song in there by Woody Guthrie's son, Woody Guthrie being one of the most famous of all-time social commentators and songwriters. Well, his son Arlo sings, coming into Los Angeles, bringing in a couple of keys. Don't touch my bag if you please, Mr. Customs Man. It seems to be arguing for drugs. And here, 25 years later, we have this disastrous, horrendous problems with hard drugs. Well, it's my own personal opinion that you should divide soft drugs from hard drugs.
but it's also my own opinion, along with Gabriella Marchesa and many other Nobel laureates, that this policy of the continued illegalization of drugs is simply not working, that we should be dealing with drugs, not as a matter of criminalness, but as a matter of sickness and disease. In fact, the criminalization of it simply keeps the problem going. It makes it huge business. It makes people kill people and damage them and beat them up in order to steal money so they can support their habit. So in a way, you have to look at what you did then. Look at the situation today and say, well, did I do the right thing? Is this sort of soft approach on drugs the right thing to do? Dale, responsibility for the Woodstock generation. Michael, well, at 14 years old, I had the nickname of Silver Tongue because I was a super debater and I was interested in a political career. In the youth in government in Ohio, I was governor of the state for the day and things like that. So I'd always been a big mouth and I had been a writer and that sort of thing. But the responsibility part of it, that wasn't really welcome. But I was raised by two very good parents who instilled in me the fact that you were supposed to step up to the plate and put your ego aside. And I'm trying, and I hope I'm doing it now, articulating concerns that a lot of people had. Part of the richness I think people ignore about Woodstock is the richness of alternatives. After all, in America, one of the big things we're supposed to be is the land of individuals, which means individual opinion, alternatives, you know. Well, I think what Woodstock symbolizes is counterculture, alternative points of view, alternative lifestyles. Question everything. And I thought that that pretty much summed up the attitude that you should never nail down your ideology. You should always remain flexible. You should always listen to the other person's point of view. Always have possibilities open to you. The biggest realization, it wasn't so much a look back as a look at a timeless situation. Country Joe's song wasn't really about the Vietnam War. It's about all wars. Joan Baez's song about Joe Hill is about all organizers. Freedom and Handsome Johnny, songs that Richie Havens sings. Summertime Blues, that there ain't no cure for them because your congressman won't get you a job. And on, they're all metaphors. They work today every bit as well as they worked yesterday. Martin Andrews, Woodstock, the Weird Wombat. Marty began with Mike Wadley's and John Binder's company, Paradigm Films, as a technical wizard, a function he performed on the movie. There's no doubt that Woodstock was the weird wombat wrenched from the womb of Merv Griffin's Sidewalks of New England TV special. First, that special was a real special. It wasn't just the usual abortion of a package stitched together by some schmuck who managed to assemble available talent with a union crew in some production facility by dealing with the usual suspects, lawyers, agents, and other assorted hacks. Like Woodstock, peace, music, multi-image location documentary, Sidewalks had a conceptual conception. Get Merv out of the studio and integrate his regulars, Arthur Treacher, etc., with others on location in New England to follow the changing fall foliage. Merv cajoled local color jokes from Judd Strunk in Vermont. A brilliant Agnes DeMille dance rendition of the Lizzie Borden story was staged in a graveyard for the highbrow audience. Paul Revere and the Raiders provided some Yankee rock and roll on top of the Prudential Building in Boston for the hipsters. There was Aretha Franklin for the black and gospel audiences. For general interest, there was the dynamic staging of a Gilbert and Sullivan piece with soloists and choruses on different balconies of buildings in Gloucester, Massachusetts. In turn, Sidewalks of New England grew out of the previous year's successful On the Sidewalks of New York, which was a similar concept shot by Wardley at outdoor metropolitan locations. The technological innovations of Woodstock sprang or evolved from technological innovations in those Sidewalks shows. Taking a massive video camera out of the studio had probably only been done previously in circumstances where the camera was dollied out of the studio door no farther than its umbilical cord would allow. Wadley has a wonderful story about how one of those enormously heavy and expensive Norelco cameras managed to get dropped off one of New York's bridges. In spite of this, and I'm sure other blunders, the decision was made to stay with the more innovative and less expensive non-union crew. Understandably, they also decided to drop the TV cameras. Not off more bridges, but as the recording medium of the subsequent Sidewalks of New England show. Wadley chose to use the newly developed Eclair NPR 16mm film camera for several reasons. His NPR was the only camera to have survived the documentary he did in the Hindu Kush. Its quick change magazine minimized the exposure to airborne dust, sand, and moisture, rain, snow, humidity, and reduced film change time. These 16mm cameras weighed about 20 pounds and were ergonomically suited to handheld operation in standing, sitting, crouching, and even prone positions. Wadley would start a shot standing, and as he crouched down, human boom shot, he would press his eye on the 360-degree orientable viewfinder, literally keeping in touch with the viewing image, and with his eye contact, force the viewfinder around as its relationship to the camera changed. He, I, and others were left-eyed, and were enabled by the design of the camera to read the f-stop and focus numbers with the right eye. This was important because these wild-eyed hippie filmmakers had the audacity to change focus and zoom while hand-holding and walking around with these NPRs. Wadley's right eye was bad enough that, although he could see the F and focus numbers, he couldn't read them. Thus, he had special rings and other accessories made up, which he sold to others at cost. I believe that those with the worst eyesight made the best camera operators because, in life, they are looking harder to compensate for their deficiency. Producers, hire cameramen who wear glasses. These cameras had a minimal noise level at 1 meter and needed no blimp because the motor's drive shaft directly turned the shutter, registration pin, and wedge-shaped claw. The mirror shutter, variable from 5 to 180 degrees, ran on a shaft below the aperture and cut the frames side to side, enabling horizontal pans with less strobe. The reflex viewing area in the ground glass showed what was just outside the film area engraving, so we could compose better as well as keep the mics out of the shot. The rotating turrets enabled us to quickly remove the zoom lens and go to the 5.9 wide-angle lens while still shooting, losing only a few frames in the rack over. This liberated us from the follow focusing and increased our mobility. It is impossible to overstate the effect that this camera design had on the rock and roll razzle-dazzle style that persists to this day. This style has been hyped beyond absurdity by MTV with its mandated quick cutting. Such hype has negated the incredible mobility and fluidity we achieved with the technology on the sidewalk show and later at Woodstock. The technology alone did not create this style. We did. The old mafia-tainted father-son IA gang could not have done it. It would never have occurred to them even to take a camera off the tripod. They had nothing but loudly voiced contempt for those of us who did. It's amusing to see movies, even today, where a hippie type is seen hand-holding a camera. It is always characterized by ludicrously spastic camera shaking. Our footage was solid. A Merv would have had us fired instantly. The relationship between film equipment and the culture that produced it is noteworthy. The German Aris are precision tanks that can be dropped or even thrown on the floor, mea culpa, and still function. The French Eclairs and Belots are high-tech marvels. The Swiss Bolexes are fussy, fingernail-breaking wind-up watches. The Japanese Doiflexes were knockoff rip-offs. The American BNCs and Panaflexes are reliable beasts that require a curious array of ancillary equipment. Dollies, cranes, camera cars, weightless rigs, and an army of union personnel to operate them. Hark, hark, the dogs bark. The hippies are coming to town. Only the young, uninitiated hippies could have discovered the capabilities of these technologies, and we were naive enough to actually make use of them. Who were we? We were baby boomers, white, middle class, male, and well-educated. I went from Allen Stevenson to Pomfret to the University of Pennsylvania, where I earned a master's not just in film, but also in the more amorphous mass communications. I hope that Dale Bell, Exeter/Princeton, will coerce educational information from other contributors. It will probably be the first time that they have professionally exposed themselves to an industry that is actively hostile to such information. There is a certain justification for this. Those crusty old veterans somehow entered the business and survived years of working for free, or in the union matrix, and have learned that one must constantly come up with unique solutions to unique problems. Pure fantasy must be turned into gut-wrenching reality. There is no such thing as the impossible. We come up with solutions to these unique problems, with our only concerns being how much it will cost and how long it will take. The last thing an old vet wants to deal with is some wise-assed kid with a degree who is maimed by concern over the conflicts between various Einsteinian montage techniques, when in fact the kid's job is to get cars parked or to schlep equipment. We were young and typically rebellious, from our Oedipal conflict with fathers wanting us to grow up and get a job, to society at large. We, in our naivete, knew it all. We knew that it was time to get real with integration. We saw through the sham and lies fed to us by our government about Vietnam. We were rebels with a cause, backed up by a phenomenally dynamic, revolutionary, and compelling music scene, augmented by the adventure of mind-expanding and life-enhancing, we thought, drugs. We not so much dropped out as we were locked out by the Union. We tuned in to what was going down by reading I.F. Stone, getting together and sharing the messages in our new music. We had long hair, funny clothes, and were acutely aware of, hip to, the difference between the bold, adventurous us, hippies, and the status quo gang. We were free radicals who had discovered our own unified field of peace, drugs, and music in a world gone mad with greed, ignorance, and stupidity. We weren't rocket scientists. It was only a month before Woodstock that NASA landed mankind on the moon, and Ted Kennedy landed Mary Jo Kopechne in the waters off Chappaquiddick. But we did have the new technology. Eclair NPR, lavaliers, shotgun mics, that could broadcast the sync signal via cordless transmitter to Nagra recorders. At the time, my three favorite, perfect pieces of technology were the Nagra recorder, the Beechcraft Bonanza airplane in which my cousin, Buckminster Fuller, flew me over the lakes and islands of Maine, and the British Leyland double-decker bus in which David Myers, Larry Johnson, and a bunch of crazies traveled through England with me and my English bride, Lizzie, on our honeymoon, just after Woodstock. Anyone out there want to edit 50,000 feet of honeymoon footage? I learned how to use this new technology by hands-on experience. When I got a gig, I would have the equipment delivered to my apartment where my friends, who were my crew and I, would load the camera and recorder with short ends. Some were as much as 400 feet to compensate us for jobs on which we knew we were going to get stiffed. We would then get high in one way or another and film our whacked-out antics in the most bizarre and innovative ways our addled minds could devise. It was this sort of innovation that got us to Woodstock. An example. Charlie Peck, who I met on sidewalks of New England, the Big B, who wasn't a part of the Wadley team but should have been, Charlie's wife Jane, Lizzie, and I had a film package delivered to Charlie's apartment in Greenwich Village. Charlie and the Big B were going to the Midwest to make a documentary about the filming of Cold Turkey, a story about a whole town that gave up smoking. Charlie and B were afraid they would be persecuted for the length of their hair. After we were pretty ripped on food, booze, and so on, Lizzie started to cut B's wild mane, while I recorded sound and Charlie covered the action with the NPR. Band one were cameramen. Charlie was a sound man. As filmmakers, we could interchange functions, and we were fluent in all film skills. Whatever shape Charlie's unadulterated mind was in, his camera work was flawless. In this case, as a sound man, he recognized the feedback noise and consciously shook the camera to augment the shock of it. As spaced out as we were in sync with each other that night. We've got the film to prove it. After the highly zonked bee had flipped out and was losing energy with a bad joke related to Goddard and the Nouvelle Vague, and I had just run out of tape, Charlie kept shooting as I put together the world's fastest on-camera Nagra reel change. The Big Bee made a fairly calm remark about losing sync. I put my headphones over his head, Lizzie stuck the scissors in his mouth, and I jammed the shotgun mic between the headphones and his ear. I then yelled, "Sink or swim!" Letting off a savage blast of feedback perceived by the Big B through the phones and the soundtrack via the mic. This propelled B into renewed paroxysms of insanity, etc., etc., etc. The resulting piece, called The Haircut, was coupled, at Marty Scorsese's request, with his thesis film, The Big Shave, retitled Shave and a Haircut, and sent off to an Italian film festival where I heard the films were understood neither individually nor collectively by the neorealism critics and audience. I think it was a bit too neo for them. Marty to the Rescue. How did I get involved with Wadley's Sidewalks of New England crew? The Eclair, as innovative as it was not the piece of perfection that the Nagra was. The Eclair's Achilles heel was its motors. With the quick magazine changes and fast pace of production, the motors kept crapping out and sync could not be maintained between the separate crews needed to provide multi-angle coverage. What to do? Help! Panic insinuated itself into the equation of filmmakers who were not that far along in experience from the always adequate film school education. The now legendary Ted Churchill came up with the solution. Me. Ted told the powers that be on Sidewalks that he knew sort of an old guy who had worked on a lot of gonzo films and had some power to stare down in humble adversity. In desperation, they bought it. And while discussing our financial vicissitudes in bed with Lizzie, the call came in telling me to take a cab to LaGuardia where there was a ticket in my name. I was to be flown in, picked up by car, and taken to a place on the Penobscot Bay in Maine. My bags are always packed, and I took off with wild enthusiasm to return to the land of my ancestors, signers of the Declaration of Independence, generals under Washington, pre-colonial governors of Connecticut and Massachusetts, a second Secretary of the Treasury, and an original Dutch settler of Manhattan. I got up the next morning and looked out of my hotel window. My God, I could actually see Bear Island, Bucky Fuller's side of my family. Nobody seemed to be up. I had no alternative. I stripped off my pajamas, ran buck naked across the lawn, and jumped into my beloved Penobscot. Once past the cardiovascular shift over to survival mode, the body glows. When you get out, every follicle of the skin sings with joie de vivre. When I got out, I was confronted by a contingent of clothed strangers led by Ted, who introduced me to them, a barrage of names that I immediately forgot, but eventually came to know as best friends and comrades in combat. Ted's incessant energy had gotten everyone pumped up to a state of embarrassing veneration for this old guy, who in actuality had just turned 29. People knew about my connection with Bucky Fuller, and I'd just gotten back from a junket in Kenya. I was able to solve the sink problem by wiring 10 12-volt batteries in series and running them through an antique World War II inverter that was controlled by aligning the vibrating fingers of some kind of tuning fork to give 60 cycles sync. Voila! We went to the stronger AC motors, which didn't crap out, and we held sync. I was not only home free, I had validated and perpetuated the veneration bestowed on me. I managed to stay half a step ahead of all the oddball troubleshooting and triage tasks that came my way, but that half step seemed to be all I needed. I was on the team, and what a team it was. What a time it was. It was Merv's show, Sidewalks of New England, that assembled the Woodstock crew, shook them down, and enabled them to develop their documentary style with Eclair NPRs, Nagra recorders, wirelesses, lavaliers, and shotgun mics. After the show was delivered to Merv, members of the crew came by Wadley's production office, some armed with their own personal footage, to re-edit Sidewalks. The music numbers on the KEM in a multiple image format became presentations for soliciting rock and roll work. It was these presentations that got us the Woodstock contract. Finally, the money that Wadley made from Sidewalks enabled him to tough it out on Woodstock to the point where Warner Brothers took it over. Hendrix had his band of gypsies. Wadley had his big band of jester, joker, juggler, jongler, jerk-off, freako, hippie, wacko sweethearts. Wadley looked like Jesus Christ, and the rest of us looked like his peripatetic leper colony. I'm a hardcore Yankee, a real down-easter, and I know and love these people. They believe good fences make good neighbors. You mind your business, I'll mind mine. But we shattered our way through every shibboleth. We left a trail of totaled rent-a-cars in our wake. We'd drive across fields, and if we couldn't get around a stone wall, we'd go through it. Call Avis,
Tell him to pick up the casualties and send replacements. We had camera dolly races down the serpentine driveway of the most pretentious motel in Sturbridge. We spun them out. We wrecked them. We sent them back to New York. We got replacements the next day. We would blast down the highways at 85 mph to make a commercial flight. Wadley's just reminded me that these flights had a limit on the size of our equipment cases, but not on their weight. Consequently, large cargo boxes were made up and we packed them so that there were no voids, no empty spaces. These mothers were stupefyingly heavy, the densest matter in the universe. The airport baggage handlers made no attempt to conceal their contempt for these unwashed, lazy hippies who descended on them. They couldn't conceive why we were even at the airport. When they had to deal with our equipment, they were instantly flummoxed. They had to get help from people whose job description did not include weightlifting and baggage wrangling. We'd be frolicking about, merry pranksters, while they reluctantly banded together, temporarily united in the task of getting rid of us. We left them dazed, discordant, disconsolate, drained. Ever hear of a car hop? Wadley redefined the expression. We were flying down the highway at maximum speed. All of a sudden, Wadley, who was driving, turned to whoever was riding shotgun and said, "Here, take the wheel and put me next to those guys, in another car to the right of ours." Whereupon he proceeded to wriggle out of his window, claw his way across the roof of the car, get on the roof of the other car, and squirm through their window to deposit himself in the laps of his nonplussed but happy to see you, "Hi, Mike, what's up? Colleagues." Epithets to aphorisms. We put the local gentry through some changes. In Gloucester, they thought they were ready for us. They weren't. They doubly weren't. They had stretched this huge sign across the main drag. It read, "Welcome to Gloucester, Massachusetts, USA, Merv Griffin and crew." Underneath were the signatures of the mayor, the board of selectmen, the library committee, the postmaster, undertaker, barber, etc., etc. The sign was enormous and was flown way up, maybe 6 stories high, across their Miracle Mile pride and joy. You remember, this was in their heyday, when the trawlers in the harbor were depleting their fisheries with impudicity. The freak crew rolled in at dusk and did a full pub crawl, going through the town's entire supply of Brandy Alexanders, which I had the honor of introducing to my new friends. This drink started out as a curiosity and evolved from a fad into a rite of passage, and then into a ritual. The revelry was intense, and the next morning we woke up to the alarming sight of the "and crew" crossed out in a sloppy but aggressive manner. It was a clear and conspicuous rejection of the long-haired louts who had ravished their night spots. In spite of the bad vibes directed at the crew the night before, the whole town turned out at dawn next day to see Merv. They were disappointed and surprised, first not to see Merv, who, with Arthur, Treacher, and the gang, didn't show up till hours later. What they saw instead was this much-reviled crew swinging into action to gussy up their already fair town with bunting and whatnot for a massive live production number. This involved prepping not just the 4 or 5 balconies that would hold Merv on one and Arthur on another and various choruses on yet others, but also the whole town as the background. It was a big deal, and maimed as we may have been by our dipsomaniacal carousings, we hit the deck running and blew them away with the intricacy of our preparatory moves. There was no budget for crowd control, so we politely asked people to make room for the power cable we had to run and all the other maneuvers required to do a multi-camera, multi-angle, big-number, big-production shoot. The locals come from good, God-fearing, no-nonsense, straight-backed Yankee Puritan witch-burning stock. They had not appreciated our nocturnal revelry, and naturally assumed that such rowdy misfits couldn't possibly have worked a day in their lives. They had no alternative but to reject this prejudice in response to the quiet but rapid and vigorous machinations they were now witnessing. They may be a proud crowd, and they may be stubborn in their righteousness, but they are not phonies. They are sufficiently secure in their house-proud way to suffer the indignity of being wrong. As the day wore on, Merv and company still not having materialized, we got into the rhythm of our zones and cranked out the work. The locals got into our numbers and began to anticipate when they might be in our way.
As they sensed our rhythm, their avoidance quickened to a shuffle. Expostulations of surprise turned to deferential grunts of embarrassment. The day ground on and our pace never slackened. We were way past what would be a mid-morning coffee break. We were cranking, baby, and the body politic was backing off, out of our way and out of the contempt in which they initially held us. They were backing off, but they were about to be routed. They had come to see Merv. They were coming to accept us. More than that, they were into our activity. They were into us. They became emboldened and started to praise us. Encouraged by our polite response, they reached further and began to apologize for the lack of civility and hospitality of whoever had altered their banner of welcome. We received this gracefully. They kept talking. We kept working. Apologies for the sign expanded to apologies for prejudging us. Obviously, we were no strangers to work. Clearly, we enjoy our work. I remembered two of the many work ethic aphorisms carved into the beams of my boathouse in Maine. For example, honor your work and your work will honor you. And the reward of good work done is more good work to do. I repeated these to the group that was now following me around. They clucked in approval, and all of a sudden we took the quantum leap and they complimented me on my L.L. Bean shoplifting jacket. Actually, a hunting jacket with ample interior pockets for transporting the tools of my trade. Oh, yes, I said, and took my first break to show them some of those essentials. Light meter, amp probe, wrenches, and so on. They loved it. It became a love fest. They began to admire the interesting clothing and hairstyles of my friends. They expressed awe at the indefatigable pace of our labor and our dedication to our calling. They invited me to their home for dinner. They had a daughter. The love fest had gotten out of control. They would have been disconsolate had they not been completely blown away by my final pièce de résistance. I must gratefully refuse your kind invitation, as tonight after we wrap this location, I have to get on Merv's private plane and fly off to Providence to shoot Aretha Franklin. Had they checked, they would have found out that by this time Merv was even more of a fan of his crew than they were. It was his pleasure not only to spirit us about in his leather-upholstered private converted DC-3 with stocked bar, but also to dine with us at the best restaurants available, enjoy our spontaneity, and even, I have reason to believe, personally foot the extravagant bills generated by these fêtes. Merv came up the hard way. He ground out a living singing in an endless succession of one-night stands in an indeterminate number of roadhouses, clubs, and other venues. He made his way into TV and became a dominant presence. The apotheosis, aesthetically, of his TV career was this Sidewalks of New England special. The special that actually was special, for him, for us on the crew, and for the audience. Merv is a very focused, ambitious, no-nonsense entrepreneur. If at any time he had had reservations about the competence of the work done by any individual or by the crew in general, that would have been it for him, or us. I am personally flattered that he appreciated our work, and I wish him well in his real estate and gaming ventures. He earned it and he deserves his success. I hope he'll invite us all down to one of his joints sometime for a reunion. It was his show, Sidewalks of New England, that assembled the Woodstock crew, shook them down, and enabled them to develop their documentary style with the Eclair NPR, Nagra recorder, wireless, lavalier, and shotgun mics. After the show we delivered to Merv, members of the crew came by Wadley's production office, some armed with their own personal footage, to re-edit Sidewalks. The music numbers on the KEM in a multi-image format became presentations for soliciting rock and roll work. It was these presentations that got us the Woodstock contract. Finally, the money that Wadley made from Sidewalks enabled him to tough it out on Woodstock to the point where Warner Brothers took it over. Charlie Peck, The So-Called 60s. Racial segregation, ecological doomsday, mindless suburban sprawl, assassinations, police riots, decaying inner cities, Lyndon Johnson and his techno-wonks and their disastrous land war in Asia. And then there was always the bomb, the hydrogen bomb.
With all this appalling crap so sharply in focus, it was not hard to develop a serious attitude problem. For Christ's sake, there must be some ideals worth considering that haven't been twisted, co-opted, or even completely forgotten about. But what were they? Where were they? Mom used to say, "Charles, you seem to be marching to the beat of a different drummer." Heck, you bet I was. In his hilarious book about class in America, Paul Fussell concludes with a chapter that deals with the different drummer types. He imagines that each complacent, insulated class is in its own private darkened theater, comfortably watching a movie that panders to all their cherished attitudes about status, dress, manners, and oh, it's all so reassuring. But a few uneasy, maybe bewildered individuals have seen enough. Quietly, they get up and slip out the side door, into the clear light of day. Discarding standard mind-numbing conventions, they are content to go it alone. In the 1960s, these outsiders got to be a lot more visible. They were dropping out in record numbers, finding each other, and beginning to adopt some interesting new values. Honesty, peace, mutual respect, odd notions like that. You rarely saw them down at the corner saloon. You never saw them at a cocktail party. For them, Mother Nature's own marijuana seemed more appropriate. Like, you know, it grows. They were colorful, persuasive, irreverent, and full of ideas about how to make the planet a lot more livable. The media loved them. And in August 1969, they had a very public party in a farmer's field near Woodstock, New York. By all accounts, it was a huge success. And 30 years later, that still has a lot of people having a snit fit, and so they insist that all of this was merely a part of some sort of seamy drug culture. Too bad. In their knee-jerk rush to sanitize the past, they not only misuse the word culture, but manage to overlook a far more intriguing phenomenon. There will always be some self-defined individuals who will never be a part of any definable anything. They just want out. They're out there all right, but for the most part unseen. They like it that way. Authors, cabinet makers, musicians, entrepreneurs, comedy writers, jewelry designers, jugglers, pastry chefs, film editors, genius freelance computer consultants, people who come and go as they please. Go ahead, call them names if you want. They could care less. And by the way, remember those oddball Puritans who, for moral and ethical reasons, sailed away from England in their wooden ships way back in 1620? All of this is very American. It's part of what makes us so special. Sexy media machines. But our story begins in France. In the mid-60s, the Eclair company was hard at work developing a revolutionary motion picture camera, the NPR. For the shutter, they used the same idea as the German RES, a rotating mirror. Below and mounted at a cocky angle was the cylindrical battery-powered motor. To replace it, all you needed was one tool, a coin. The lens turret featured a new insert and twist bayonet mount. This meant that the lens, usually an ingenue zoom lens, could be replaced in less than 2 seconds with one hand. But the best part was the camera's magazine/transport system. The sprockets, pressure plate, and film loops were incorporated into each film magazine. That meant that a fresh roll of 400 feet of raw stock, 11 minutes, could be snapped to the back of the shutter assembly, ready to roll in less than a second. And all designed and hand-assembled for one purpose: to try to insert a silent, handheld motion picture camera inconspicuously into any interesting real-life situation, anywhere. And to record the sound along the way, the NPR was designed to work with another European masterpiece, the Swiss-made Nagra portable tape recorder. Compact, rugged, precise, it was about the size of 5 bricks lashed together and almost as heavy. The Swiss Army tape recorder. The only time I ever saw equipment like this was aboard a marine amphibious assault ship. Talk about heavy duty. You could smack the control panel with the butt of your Swiss Army rifle, and nothing would happen. Everything was recessed. Oh, but when you opened it up and looked inside, the sight of the motors, pulleys, and electronics was breathtaking. Handcrafted with not a cubic centimeter of space wasted. Parallel colored wires, cute little transistors, all carefully arranged and accented with shiny, silvery, perfectly soldered connections. And it was there in all those unseeable, complex electronics that the engineers at Nagra had really done it. The sound it recorded was rich and pure, crystalline highs, gut-punching lows, almost as faithful as any recording studio in its time. And all there in that indestructible, portable box. The suspension of disbelief versus belief. As it was with many new developments during the turbulent 60s, the nifty movie equipment from Europe came with a vision, maybe even a responsibility. Innovative technology could and should be used to bring about positive social and political change. By replacing bulky and expensive studio cameras with more advanced portable 16mm systems, events could now be documented as they unfolded, in real time. There would be no need to narrate or pontificate. What happened in front of the lens would be powerfully and intimately real. By documenting political campaigns, prisons, mental hospitals, even a war, films could now be made that might move people to do something about society's ills. In their self-satisfied fashion, the French called it cinema verite, the true movies. Vive la différence. A cadre of cinema saboteurs creating a radical, subversive film genre. And the folks over at Eclair had done their job perfectly, because as it is with any artfully conceived and carefully crafted piece of machinery, the NPR camera could cast a powerful spell. When young Michael Wadley saw it, he was a goner. He left a promising future at Columbia Medical School, and off he went with his friend John Binder doing the sound, filming a team of mountain climbers up through the snow and ice to 20,000 feet. According to Michael, "That little Claire never let me down. Sweet machine. She was a bit hefty, but very sweet." When I saw it for the first time in 1968 at Michael and John's office, Paradigm Films on 86th Street, my reaction was the same. It was just so sexy. "Go ahead, put me on your shoulder. Let's have a little fun, Sherry." Ah, romance, adventure, cinema verite. She was French, you know. But as Michael says, she was a bit hefty. The Eclair NPR weighed 27 pounds, and after holding it on your shoulder for 10 minutes or so, your forearm would begin to ache and shake. The image in the viewfinder would start to sway and wobble, and that was au revoir, Sherry. Fortunately, there were a few who could get through that. Rock steady. Do you remember the ninja from James Clavell's book, Shogun? Those were the guys who could stand on one foot in the freezing rain, perfectly motionless, all night, and then, like Spider-Man, scale a sheer vertical wall and assassinate somebody. "Ah, so, you are a most worthy ninja. You understand that the pain exists only in your mind, and therefore does not exist at all." That's what it took. Filming with the NPR required cerebral cortex denial. But once that mindbender was accomplished, a person could carry that beautiful camera anywhere. But these handheld camera people had to have much more than that. The new cinema verite required that they be creative types as well, athletic artists with an eye for detail. And the best of them had a sympathetic concern about other people's lives. This assured that they were always curious, alert, very important. There was always the chance that somewhere out there, something might just happen and not get documented. There was no director, no rehearsals, no script. This was the truth, 24 frames a second. Traditional film and television production in those days was like an assembly line, existing for the convenience of corporations and unions. What we were up to was more like team sports. The methods we developed were highly mobile, just camera and sound,
with someone nearby running interference while reloading the film magazines. And none of those blinding movie lights. Just force process the film. No Winnebagos, no Teamsters, no craft services, no trucks full of stands, cookies, dots, flags, scrims, gels, sandbags, and 5,000-watt generators. The result was sometimes raw and grainy, but it was always true. True grit. We tried to be inconspicuous, staying ahead of the action. Relaxed, silent, moving, just going with the flow. Anywhere. One producer from NET, Mort Silverstein, didn't even bother leaving his motel room. He just sent us out there to do our documenting. Here's an example that would come later from the Woodstock movie. One of the cameramen at Woodstock was David Myers. At 55 years of age, he was by far the oldest member of the film crew and a past master at this going-with-the-flow-anywhere stuff. And for some reason, he walked right past the rock stars, right past the flower children, and discovered an average American, the Portisan Man, busily servicing the public toilets. I can still see David turning to his sound man and shrugging, "What the hell, let's do it. Let's document." Could Dan Rather or anyone from the networks have done this? The very idea is laughable. But at Woodstock, David and his sound man treat the Portisan Man with respect. They are patient, just having a chat, rolling all the time. There is no interview. If you were a twee, what kind of twee would you be? And pretty soon the guy relaxes and comes up with his own touching irony. He has a son fighting in the war we are all railing against. Who knows, that son might be dead as he speaks. And he has another son right there at the festival shouting, "Give me an F-U-C-K. Be the first one on your block to have your son come home in a box." Whew. Most of us who have seen the movie remember this moment. A perceptive and thoughtful man caught up in an all-too-familiar 1960s dilemma. He shared a bit of himself that day, and we love him. But I'm getting ahead of myself. Let's begin again. Too Much, the Magic Bus. It was 1968. I was 26 years old and living in New York City when my pal Chuck Levy came to me with exciting news. Chuck was a terrific still photographer who had found out about the Eclair NPR and the Verite film style from Messrs. Binder and Wadley. And after I checked it out, I knew exactly what to do. I gave notice at my comfortable job at the Channel 13 art department, and off I went. Ah, adventure, romance, cinema verite. Well, maybe not so verite. John and Michael had convinced Merv Griffin and his producer Bob Shanks that Paradigm Films could apply its freewheeling filmmaking style to an upcoming star-studded Thanksgiving TV special. What a stretch. America's adorable daytime talk show host and assorted glitzy show folk on the road with a bunch of radical film freaks. But it just so happened that behind that boyish, affable charm, Mr. Griffin was a bit of an adventurer. He was interested in getting out of his hot, overlit television studio and finding something over the horizon, filming musical performances in various locations with multiple cameras. And for this, Merv had the perfect vehicle. An airplane that still enjoys a long and glorious history of being able to go anywhere. The venerable DC-3. All us hippie filmmakers took one look at this gleaming silver antique and just piled right in and off we went. There were 8 of us, all in our mid-20s, and all charged up with a curious, freaky esprit de corps. The journey was boisterous and arduous and led by our own dynamo mojo, Michael Wadley, ninja ne plus ultra. Enigmatic, quiet by nature, built like a wide receiver and with piercing blue eyes, Michael radiated an intense yet benevolent authority, on which this trip demanded that everyone involved find the freedom to explore. And explore we did. We had to. Filming with multiple cameras like this had never been tried before, so we had to sort of make it up as we went along. And if confusion, doubt, or exhaustion intruded, well, just check out the intrepid Mr. Wadley. Calm, focused, alert, just going with the flow. He demonstrated some Newtonian physics for us one morning by sliding off the tailgate of an accelerating station wagon onto a runway at Logan Airport in Boston. And as he went skidding and bouncing along the concrete, we all shared one vivid, horrifying reality check. If anything should ever happen to Michael, the exploring would be all over. Shit. But of course, nothing would ever happen to Michael. He was like a Terminator. No problemo. After completing his interesting little slide for life, he just got up and got back in the car, his striped sport shirt in shreds, and off we went. Where to, Michael? The question needed no answer. By this time, we were moving fast forward with our own hippie gusto, perfecting sync sound, three-camera handheld shooting in the wilderness. At first, there were problems keeping all three cameras in sync. Technical note. Keeping three cameras running at exactly the same speed was difficult in the days before crystal-controlled motors. So our whiz kid, Marty Andrews, devised a power source driven by 10 car batteries and a special transformer called an inverter, delivering 120 volt 60 cycle power to the alternating current motors of the three NPRs. Same alternating current, same camera speed. Once everything was all in sync, the exploration continued. It was challenging, because Maestro Wadley was always busy choreographing some new multi-camera ballet, shooting from cars, boats, and helicopters. Our irrepressible sound man Larry Johnson called it the Holly Gully, and Michael's vision soon had the three cameramen, Michael, Chuck Levy, and Ted Churchill, literally running circles around the flat, formal proscenium look of the day. We finished the shooting in about 4 weeks. Damn it, we were having so much fun! But I had helped to slay the multi-camera sink-in-the-wilderness beast. I had earned a seat at the Paradigm Roundtable. I was at the wheel as we headed back to Camelot at an average speed of 85 miles per hour on the Massachusetts Turnpike. After all, there was so much more to document. The Quest of Sir Martin. It was a typical early morning on the Merv trip. All us bell-bottomed long hairs in some faraway motel parking lot, sipping coffee, when into our midst walked the latest addition to our crew, Martin Lord Andrews VII, sporting an iridescent orange jumpsuit. We all looked at each other and just knew this wild ride was about to become a lot more, experimental. Technically, things had gotten a little out of hand, and Marty had come prepared. Circuit tester, ammeter, metric alien wrenches, epoxy, dental tools, soldering tools, jeweler's tools, fuses, plugs, adapters, connectors, and something called a space blanket, all lovingly organized in nesting fishing tackle boxes. He had adapted the L.L. Bean duck hunting, fly fishing thing to our gopher broke production style, and always seemed to be nearby reaching into his field jacket to produce an extra core, sync cable, 85ND number 3 lens filter, a Q-tip. And the odd thing was, you couldn't tell how old he was. This was partly due to his voice. As coxswain for the University of Pennsylvania crew team, he had blown out some of his vocal cords. Now he spoke in a lilting baritone croak. But it wasn't just the voice. Marty had an honest, worldly, preoccupied eccentricity that is usually associated with a long and full life. Man, he was so weird he didn't even have long hair. We had all read and talked about becoming so-called filmmakers. Marty seemed to be the real deal. So when we got back to New York, his place on 15th Street became our after-hours experimental film salon. Far from the chitty-chitty bang-bang world, our own home movie, Merlin, was in there kicking down the doors of perception. Marty's experimental films were weird, shocking, and sometimes funny, like his short film, Banana Head, a story about smuggling contraband hallucinogenic fruit. The hall running the length of his apartment was impassable. It was crammed full of projectors, all types, 16mm, 8mm, Super 8mm, slide projectors, all aimed at a rear projection screen in the doorway to his cozy living room. There were two cats, three beautiful aquariums, a lava lamp,
and a refrigerator full of sparkling French apple wine. Of course, the whole place was wired for sound, speakers everywhere. The walls were covered with photos, memorabilia, interesting paintings and tapestries, and the windows were all covered up too, because Marty was seriously into film. And his skill and enthusiasm were so infectious that right away Ted Churchill, Larry Johnson, and I got our 8mm cameras and we were getting into film. Raw stock? We pre-fogged it. We post-fogged it. We froze it. We baked it. Once we fucked up 50 feet of Kodachrome so bad, the emulsion fell off at Kodak's processing plant in Fairlawn, New Jersey. Oops. Sorry. Double exposures? Hell, quadruple exposures. Get ready for this, guys. I ran the same piece of film through my little 8mm camera 22 times, shooting out the front of the Flushing Line train. Grand Central to Shea Stadium, Shea Stadium to Grand Central. Back and forth, all night. Far out, Charlie. The result was like driving through an exploding supernova. Ted Churchill really got into single framing. On a crisp autumn afternoon, he would take his Bolex out for a stroll, clicking one frame of film every 2 or 3 seconds. Of course, as we sat in Marty's permanently darkened living room and watched, at 24 frames a second, Ted's wanderings got speeded up, like up to about 100 miles per hour. But, oh, wait, he stopped at a stop sign, and, oh, wow. He's getting into the stop sign. He's exploring the stop sign one frame at a time. He's getting into the word stop, the letter forms. He's getting into the octagonal geometry of the stop sign. And pretty soon he's got that inanimate symbol of authority pulsating, vibrating, spinning out of control until you couldn't even tell if it was a stop sign or a kaleidoscope anymore. My God, Teddy must have been there all afternoon. You could tell. Because in the last 4 or 5 seconds of this masterpiece, he began to lose the light. Evening arrived. The city lights began to sparkle, fade to black. Marty and I were floored. Bravo, Teddy! Bravo! Then the phone rang. It was Larry up at Paradigm. Get up here right away. The KEM is here. Three screens. And that's the way it was. All of us downtown at Marty's getting into it. John and Michael smiling approvingly at our antics while going out and spending their own money in the real world, keeping Paradigm Films on the cutting edge. They had moved their office into a bright, spacious place overlooking Broadway on the Upper West Side. It was late in the evening when we arrived, and there it was, direct from Germany. The biggest, most advanced, most expensive film editing console in the world. We couldn't get close to it because there were 3 or 4 technicians making it work with American electricity. So we returned the next morning, bright and early. Chuck, Larry, Marty, and myself. We couldn't wait to get into this Teutonic beauty. We brought with us all the crazy footage we could find, like my green and red high-contrast shot from the front of the roller coaster ride at Coney Island. And we needed a lot of footage, too, because the KEM had 3 screens, 3 big screens. Anyone familiar with Rube Goldberg's Moviola can imagine our excitement. No more clattering, chattering antique with that dinky screen and always tearing up the sprocket holes. The KEM used rotating prisms and had a terrific sound system. And that meant rock and roll. 3 screens, 2 screens, 1 screen. Blast off! Hendrix, Doors, Beatles. We transformed that luxurious editing console into our own funky 3-screen music-driven multiple image theater. And once we got it all going, there were so many more possibilities. Beautiful, sometimes literal associations presented themselves. Mirror images, repeat images, curious juxtapositions, reality dissolving into a wild light show. Someone put together a beautiful 3-screen version of Aretha Franklin's performance from the Merv show. The splicing and fooling around went on for days, weeks. We were having so much fun that it took me a while to notice that Michael was becoming a lot more enigmatic than usual. As it turned out,
He was busy planning the ultimate handheld multiple-camera-in-the-wilderness documentary ever. Someone had decided to organize an outdoor arts and crafts and music festival near an upstate village named Woodstock, and Michael Wadley was exploring again. Good vibrations. Financial backing? There wasn't any. But there was the spirit. Youthful, fresh, audacious, and cocky. It made some folks uncomfortable, but it was our spirit, and we loved it. There, I've gone and said it. Love. We loved our sexy machines. We loved each other. We loved challenges, exploring, being alive in the world. We loved our rock and roll music, the best background music any generation ever had. We loved our pioneering cinema verite. We thought it was important. And if there was ever any doubt, well, just check out the intrepid Mr. Wadley. Calm, focused, alert, just going with the flow. Naturally, Michael was able to attract a lot of talented people. Seasoned producer types like Dale Bell and Bob Maurice came along to take care of business and logistics. Besides Chuck Levy and Ted Churchill, other great cameramen, David Myers, Don Lenzer, Ed Lynch, and Dick Pierce came along, and they had the spirit too. Day by day, more and more young, talented film people, like Martin Scorcese, Thelma Schoonmaker, and Marty Andrews, became involved with the spirit. And in spite of financial and logistical obstacles, the film crew of about 80 went up to Woodstock and returned with 350,000 feet of history, with hardly a slate in it. No problem. The spirit and a lot of money from Warner Brothers got it in sync right away. Did I say Warner Brothers? Apparently there were kindred spirits out there in Tinseltown, too. Far out. We all enjoyed the day-long, night-long three-screen screenings. What a party! And then, as the final editing process approached, the whole thing packed up and went to Hollywood. But those of us left behind still had the spirit. Louis Teague, the original Bob Maurice. Louis became our advance man in Hollywood prior to our move in December 1969. Bob and I were fast friends in high school in North Tarrytown, in Westchester County, New York. The first time I ever got drunk was when I was 14, when I drank a quart of gin with Bob on the high school bleachers before a football game. We shared many adventures, including being chased by the police and stolen cars. He was 16 years old and went to jail for that. Since I was only 15, I went to a youth detention home. When I turned 17, I quit high school and joined the Army. I lost touch with Bob for 3 years. When I got out of the Army and decided to go back to school, I somehow tracked Bob down and was shocked at what I found. In North Tarrytown, Bob lived in a tiny walk-up apartment with his French-Canadian blue-collar parents. It seemed that every time I visited them, everyone was screaming, and Bob was destroying his collection of jazz LPs by smashing them, throwing them, or stomping on them. He was an extraordinary jazz buff, constantly replacing his collection, only to destroy it again. When I looked him up after the Army, I expected to find the same guy, blue-collar, uneducated, and having skirmishes with the law. Instead, I found a guy who had already been in City College for several years and was passionate about books and learning. He hadn't discarded the blue-collar aspect of his personality, only added to it. He continued to pay his way through college by working construction. He became a professional student, eventually going to college for about 9 years. I don't know if he ever earned his baccalaureate, but he certainly became one of the most well-read and knowledgeable people I've ever encountered. But when it came time to produce Woodstock, Bob credited his years on the construction site with giving him the skills he needed. Working construction. Two guys want to dump their wheelbarrow bricks in the same spot. The problem is solved by assuming an aggressive stance and saying, "Hey, fuck you, that's my spot." Dealing with the studios is a lot like that, he said. He had the charm and intelligence to make that kind of toughness work. Bob Maurice hired me to work on Woodstock. Even though I had known Michael Wadley for some time, and had in fact introduced the two of them, I had known Bob since childhood. So when he needed someone on the West Coast to be an advance man, I'm the one he called. He needed someone to find workspace for the huge post-production crew that was already at work editing the film in New York. As it was a non-union production, Bob wanted to stay away from the studio. They also needed housing for the crew, and in the spirit of the time, it was decided that some sort of communal arrangement would be most satisfactory and less expensive. It wasn't difficult to find three houses on Franklin, Genesee, and Orlando that would rent to us. The hard part was finding and setting up editing space that would fulfill our needs. We needed half a dozen editing rooms to accommodate the new KEM flatbed editing machines, plus rooms for assistants, space for sound editors, a screening room, and offices for Bob, Mike, and Dale, etc. Working with several realtors, I found space on Yucca and Vine that seemed to fit the bill in terms of space and price. Of course, we needed to do extensive electrical rewiring. The most interesting challenge was setting up a screening room where we could screen the work print. We needed to run 5 16mm projectors run in sync with the soundtrack. It's my opinion that the experience of screening the work print was far more exciting than seeing the finished film. The visual area in front of us was apparently larger. It was rougher and more dynamic. The quality of the work prints was better than the final film, which had to go many generations before it reached the screen. And it was definitely louder and longer. Once Mike and Bob arrived from New York, most of my job was finished. I had made many of the initial contacts with the optical labs, but when Dale Bell arrived, he took over. I stayed on as a glorified production assistant, helping out Bob where I could, and watched the film come together. We all knew we were working on something important. The end of the year, not to mention decade, was approaching, and all the magazines were declaring Woodstock one of the defining moments of the 60s. Mike had extraordinary charisma. He was very bright, supremely confident, and a gifted craftsman. He was very focused, seemed to have unlimited energy, and had a vision. Several years earlier, I had been visiting Mike in an editing room in New York, where he was cutting a documentary about Aretha Franklin. He wanted to show me the new Keller editing machine he was working on that allowed him to view three shots in sync with one soundtrack, since the performance sequences had been filmed with multiple cameras.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.